Welcome to the Skeptic Zone, the podcast from Australia for science and reason.
Hello and welcome to the Skeptic Zone, episode number 378 for the 17th of January 2016. Richard Saunders here with you from Sydney, Australia. Coming up on this week's show, we're going to have Jo Alabaster with Evidence, Please. Now, just the other day on the Sunrise Morning TV show here in Australia, one Pauline Hanson appeared to talk about various issues, as she does. And Australians are very familiar with Pauline Hanson. She talked about vaccination as part of her general discussions and made what we might call some very silly remarks. So I'm going to play the clip of Pauline Hanson with some other people talking about this issue, followed by Jo Alabaster's reply, Jo Alabaster's open letter. Well done, Jo. After that, it's a week in science from the Royal Institution of Australia, www.riaus.org.au. And then it's the welcome return of Dr. Rachie, Dr. Rachael Dunlop, with Dr. Rachie Reports. Now, Dr. Rachie is going to be speaking about the issue of the week. The issue of the week. This is the awarding of a PhD to a anti-vaccination zealot, we could almost say, I think. From the University of Wollongong, lots of eyebrows being raised. This is widely seen as being a very bad decision on the part of the University of Wollongong. Anyway, Dr. Rachie will tell us more about that. And to follow that, I'll be reading the report, the statement released by Australian skeptics on this issue. I guess the other big news stories of the week floating about are the recent deaths of very famous people. Now, you know, people say things come in threes. Well, there's been four, five famous people die in the last couple of weeks. Anyway, if you listen right at the end of the show, right past the closing theme, there's a little Easter egg this week as I pay tribute to one of these famous people who just died. But now it's time for me to run downstairs. If Fred the cat will let me, he waits on the stairs. You walk down the stairs, suddenly there's a cat under your feet. Cat owners will know what I'm talking about. It's time for me to run downstairs, have some scrambled eggs and mashed potatoes on toast with a little bit of grated cheese on top. Why not? While I'm doing that, I hope you enjoy The Skeptic Zone.
What we want is some more evidence, please. Here's Jo Alabaster.
Hello, this is Jo Alabaster.
School holidays still. Lots of other families and their kids will be at the zoo. At this time.
Eddie, if the other kids have had their vaccinations, what's the problem here? Of course these people can travel to the zoo and go to the zoo. What a stupid statement by the health minister. I mean, say these people are in shopping centres, they're around the place. I think the whole thing to do with vaccinations should be a common sense debate. I think what's getting up people's concerning people here is that the nanny approach the government's taking, that they'll just implement and tell people what they have to do without educating people. I had my kids vaccinated, but I tell you what, I think twice about it these days. And if the government wants to be responsible,
they should have thought about it years ago.
Why, Pauline? Why would you think twice now? 37%. Why would you think twice now? Well, and you have grandkids as well. Are they vaccinated?
No, one of my children, grandchildren, is not vaccinated. That was their parents' choice not to vaccinate them. So there is debate, and I spoke to a lot of people years ago about vaccination. So I think there should be a debate and educational process with this. When the government brought in people from African country and only 37% were actually tested for diseases, now Tony Abbott admitted that when he was health minister, I think the government needs to step up first and ensure that this people they bring in the country don't carry these diseases, like tuberculosis.
I think we should start the fluoridation debate again now. I really do. I'm worried that I turn my tap on, I get water there, and the water's fluoridated, and I didn't ask for it when
Darren,
I was born.
Darren, stop
this
being
is
so
rubbish.
Bloody sarcastic and smart.
I'm being sarcastic because you are being irresponsible. You are being irresponsible on national television, and I get accused of interrupting you on this day. I'm more than happy to be accused of interrupting you because you're talking dangerous rubbish.
Hi, Pauline. This morning on Sunrise, you asked, quote, if the other kids have had their vaccinations, what's the problem here? End quote. I'd like to take the opportunity to explain some of the reasons that parents who do vaccinate their kids are concerned about other parents choosing not to vaccinate. First of all, some kids are too young to be vaccinated. Fortunately, we're able to offer babies some protection from whooping cough with maternal third trimester booster shots for pregnant mums, but until a baby has had their third pertussis vaccine at 6 months old, their vulnerability to catching whooping cough is significant. Here's a link to the Australian Immunisation Schedule, where you can look up the ages at which children can be protected from various diseases. Secondly, some children cannot be immunised for medical reasons. Think kids with cancer undergoing chemotherapy. We can help protect these kids from further illness by keeping vaccine-preventable diseases out of our communities, by immunising those that we can. Third, unfortunately, no vaccine is 100% effective. This is why we need to have as many people as possible vaccinated. The more people are immune to a disease, the less chance that that disease will have to progress through a community. And fourth, and I'm speaking for myself here, although I'm sure many parents who do vaccinate their kids will agree with me, I don't want to see any kid catching whooping cough, measles or chickenpox, regardless of their parents' beliefs about medicine. I don't want the parents who've placed trust in anti-vaccination campaigners to go through the pain of having a critically ill child, a child who lives with a permanent disability due to a preventable disease, or a child who has died. Thanks for your time, Pauline. I hope that I've answered your question. Please let me know if I can clarify any of this further. Jo Alabaster.
Welcome to A Week in Science from RiAus. Coming up in this week's episode, Australia's prehistoric population, lab-made petrol, and climate. In Australia, we now have 23 million people. Make that 23 million and one. So it's timely to look back at our prehistoric population. Radiocarbon dates from thousands of archaeological sites were compiled to determine that only 1,000 to 2,000 people formed Australia's founding population. This initial small group arrived about 50,000 years ago, then grew to approximately 1.1 million people at the time of European contact. The data also revealed the impacts of climatic events and other factors on Australia's first inhabitants. Low-fibre diets and high-fat intakes may worsen asthma by increasing airway inflammation and reducing lung function. We're finally saying farewell to genital warts, with diagnoses dropping up to 59% since the HPV vaccine was introduced 5 years ago. Marijuana pills provide more effective pain relief than smoking the drug, and scientists have used genetically engineered bacteria to create petrol in the lab that's identical to what you buy at the pump. Three studies this week have provided further insight into our changing climate. First up, a compilation of over 500 climate records revealed that 1970 to 2000 was the warmest period globally for the past 1400 years. Meanwhile, a second study found that around 20% of all land will change climate zone by the end of this century, increasing the risk of species extinction. And finally, changing rainfall patterns in the tropics may not depend on surface temperature, but instead be a direct result of increasing atmospheric carbon dioxide. And that's been the highlights of another big week in science. For more information and science news, check out the RiAus website at riaus.org.au, where you can sign up for notifications of future episodes. And don't forget to follow A Week in Science on Twitter using the hashtag WeekInSci. I'm Tania Meyer, and on behalf of the RiAus team, see you next week.
Want to help support the Skeptic Zone and look pretty damn stylish while you're about it? Visit Mr. Cat's Origami Jewelry. Go to www.skepticzone.tv and click the link, or simply Google Mr. Cat's Origami Jewelry, also on Facebook. Pendants, earrings, and cufflinks. Support Mr. Cat. Support the Skeptic Zone.
Now it's time for Dr. Rachie Reports with Dr. Rachael Dunlop.
Yes, it's Dr. Rachie Reports with Dr. Rachael Dunlop on the line now from a mysterious location. Hello, Dr. Rachie.
Hi, Richard. How are you? I am in a mysterious location, actually, somewhere in Victoria. I'm not even sure where I am, but we do have enough coverage to do this interview, I hope.
Oh, it seems to be working well. You're no doubt on some clever undercover investigation.
I can't reveal or confirm or deny that information.
All right. Well, let's get to the matter in hand. Of course, in the last week, it's been a big news week generally, but this news coming out of the University of Wollongong is, for our point of view, from the skeptical and scientific point of view, it's really quite dramatic. Can you give our listeners a quick background?
Yeah, so this week, or actually just in a few weeks ago, a PhD was awarded to a quite well-known anti-vax campaigner here in Australia. Her name is Judy Wileyman, and she's been studying a PhD at the University of Wollongong for quite some time now. Prior to that, she was studying the same topic at Murdoch University in Western Australia, and she was doing it in the humanities department, not in the science department. So, in fact, her thesis, which is entitled A Critical Analysis of the Australian Government's Rationale for its Vaccination Policy, has come out and has been placed online, and we've all read it, and it's pretty severely lacking in any sort of scientific accuracy or novel research.
That's surprising. I must say that's surprising, because we've known about her for quite a long time. She's quite vocal online in her views and opinions. And for a long time, she was simply classified or called herself a PhD student. And then almost out of nowhere, she's granted a PhD. But yes, the thing that's really worrying from our point of view is she's got this in what we more or less consider to be conspiracy theory nonsense. But the sad repercussion is it's given fuel to the anti-vaccination lobby.
Well, I haven't actually seen that manifest yet, but it will give them that credibility, because now she's entitled to call herself Dr. Judy Wileyman. So that is going to lend legitimacy to her claims. And for some time, she has run a website, a Facebook page, and has sent out newsletters full of the standard kind of anti-vax canards that we've all come to know and love. And going through her thesis is also like a game of anti-vax bingo. You know, there's the references to the Rockefellers and the conspiracies, and that vaccinations weren't used on a large scale until the government got in cahoots with pharmaceutical companies. I mean, it's the really sort of extreme end of the anti-vax loons. This kind of information that you'd find on Google, which has no place whatsoever in an academic institution, unless you're critically analysing that from a social science point of view. But unfortunately, she's neither done that, nor has she done it from a scientific point of view. So instead, we get basically crazy loon bag rants that you might find on any standard anti-vax blog. And this is not worthy of anything, probably even undergraduate level research, let alone a PhD.
It is surprising. It really is surprising. And I imagine from what you've seen, the backlash against the University of Wollongong has been quite strident.
Look, it has. And personally, I think it's justified because this lowers the respect for the university, and it also tars alumni and staff with the same brush. It devalues a PhD at that university, but possibly you could go as far as to say it devalues all PhDs if this is the sort of stuff they're awarding a higher graduate degree. And there's a lot of people at the University of Wollongong who work in the health sciences and science faculties who are really genuinely pissed off, because really what's happened here is this is someone's referred to this as a PhD by stealth. And what they mean by that is that this should have gone through, because it covers vaccination and humanities, it should have had supervisors with expertise in both those areas. And if anyone who had science expertise or epidemiology or vaccination expertise had examined this properly, there is no way in hell it would have got passed. So there are other academics now at the University of Wollongong saying, hang on a second, there's something really wrong in the state of Denmark if this kind of stuff is getting through our system. There must be some problem at the University of Wollongong for this to occur.
Well, I imagine there are people at the University of Wollongong now looking at the social media backlash especially. But that's one thing. I mean, there's social media backlash against all sorts of things. We've all seen that. But I think more importantly, there's a lot of backlash from very eminent and qualified people.
Well, this is true. And this story was picked up by the Australian newspaper on last week. I think it had four straight days of coverage. There were four stories in a row covering this from all aspects. And, you know, Professor Peter McIntyre, who is an advisor to the WHO on vaccination policy and a director at the National Centres for Immunisation Research and Surveillance, he stepped forward and said, I offered to give her advice. I offered to look over this thesis, but she was unwilling to have her ideas challenged.
Well, now, this is... That's typical anti-vaccination, isn't it?
It's typical pseudoscience. And the other thing, too, is that the university has been defending this until they're blue in the face. And one of their defences is that it was examined by two independent examiners and their knowledge is unchallengeable. Now, this, too, is a massive red flag, because nothing in academia should be unchallengeable. No ideas are unchallengeable. And especially in science, nothing is unchallengeable. Theories are overturned all the time. Science is self-correcting. We learn new things all the time. So for them to say that these examiners have unchallengeable knowledge is just bizarre.
To have such an obvious logical fallacy, which is ultimately the appeal to authority coming out from a statement by the university. So I guess what they're doing is what we call they're doubling down. They're really they're digging themselves deeper, would you say?
Yeah, look, for the last 5 days, their defence has been academic freedom. Now, academic freedom is supposed to allow for the free flow of ideas without the people being penalised or undergoing any issues because they want to present controversial ideas. And I absolutely support that idea. I've worked in academia myself. It's important to provide an environment where people can put out ideas that might be seen as controversial, but that has to go along with academic rigor. So you have to do that by analysing a problem properly with evidence to back it up. And if you're going to come out and say that the entire vaccination policy run by the Australian government is because of a conspiracy that was formed by the WHO and the Rockefellers, you need some pretty good evidence for that. what was it that Carl Sagan used to say? Extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence.
Absolutely.
Well, this does not have that extraordinary evidence. So basically, this is a really shoddy piece of publication. It is really quite embarrassing. And I don't know if that's why the university is doubling down. Just to give you a bit of context, this issue has been followed up by the members of Stop the Australian Vaccination Network for many years. And indeed, official complaints have been made throughout those years, and those complaints have been dismissed on every single occasion. So the university should not be surprised that this is the outcome once they granted this PhD. However, they seem to be. And I do think that you're right, that they are doubling down and they're hoping it goes away. But unfortunately for them, there are quite a few people who are pretty tenacious and will not let this go, because this is not only a kick in the face to people who have PhDs, it's not only a kick in the face to other academics and particularly science academics at UOW, it is a big point scoring incident for the anti-vaxxers. And so this needs to have a review, and it needs to be independently reviewed, because we don't think this thesis is worthy of a PhD.
I absolutely agree. And you know very well what it's like to go through the process to get a PhD, of course.
Well, yes, I do. And I can tell you that I would have not, I would never even think of submitting something like this to my supervisor. I'd be laughed out of the room. And, you know, and the process of a PhD involves annual reviews where your work is supposed to be checked, and it's supposed to be independently checked, and you're supposed to give seminars to the department. So it appears to me that this wasn't done thoroughly enough, if at all, because how this kind of stuff got through independent assessment, even, you know, in-house seminars, and people just said, yeah, that sounds good, I have no idea.
It's absolutely right. We're still quite all very much surprised about it. Well, thanks, Dr. Rachie, for that update. After this segment, I'll read out the report that the Australian Skeptics have put on their website. But before we go, it's been a while since you've been on the Skeptic Zone. I know you've been very busy. What have you been up to, Rachie?
Well, I'm sort of spending my time now halfway between America and Australia. I'm working on still working on motor neuron disease research, and so part of the work I'm doing now is at Macquarie University in Sydney, and part of it is in Jackson Hole, Wyoming, which most people haven't heard of and don't know where it is. So I'm very lucky at the moment to be allowed to spend some time in Australia, because at the moment in Jackson Hole it's minus 27 degrees Celsius, and for people that ski and like that kind of thing, that's great, but yeah. I'm not one of those people.
Okay.
Before we go, Richard, can I just add that Stop the Australian Vaccination Network set up a Facebook page today where we're collating critiques of the thesis so that we can put those all in one place, and we can have one document that critiques it very thoroughly. So if listeners would like to go to Judy Wileyman PhD Thesis Critique page on Facebook, and please, even if you spot one tiny little thing, for example, there's examples where she's referenced things wrong. She's referenced a book from the 1800s 27 times. Even if you spot something very tiny, it doesn't take much of an effort to just go to this Facebook page, chuck it in there, and then we will compile it as a big document and use that down the track.
Excellent. Well, I'll certainly link to that in the show notes, and I'll make a link from this week's entry at the Facebook page of The Skeptic Zone. Well, Dr. Rachie, we look forward to more interviews and reviews and reports coming up from you. But for today, in your secret location on your secret mission, thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Richard.
From the website of Australian Skeptics, www.skeptics.com.au, Bent's Boon for University of Wollongong, by Tim Mendham, dated 15th of January 2016. Australian Skeptics is receiving many Bent Spoon nominations for the University of Wollongong for its approval of a PhD thesis by a notorious anti-vaccination campaigner, Julie Wileyman, called, quote, "A Critical Analysis of the Australian Government's Rationale for its Vaccination Policy," end quote. Wileyman's thesis describes what she calls, quote, "the political framework in which the policy is affected by biased science or undone, unfounded science," end quote, and claims, quote, the existence of institutional barriers to carrying out independent research, including on topics unwelcome to the groups with vested interests, end quote. She includes collusion between industry and health authorities, particularly that the World Health Organization, quote, is perceived to be out of touch with global communities and it is controlled by the interests of corporations and the World Bank, end quote. This level of conspiracy is continued, quote, powerful pro-vaccination lobby groups such as the Australian Skeptics and Stop the Australian Vaccination Network, SAVN, influence politicians and the media. They also use social blogs to ridicule and abuse individuals, including academics and professionals, who are questioning the safety and efficacy of vaccines. Brackets, Martin, 2015, end brackets. There is evidence that lobby groups in many countries are being founded by industry to promote industry interests. These groups discredit people's reputations and promote disinformation to suppress scientific debate, end quote. Conspiracy theories are supplemented with numerous claims about the efficacy and safety of vaccination and vaccines that have been covered and debunked many times before. The reference to Martin, as mentioned above, is to Professor Brian Martin, her primary supervisor at the University of Wollongong, whom she thanks, quote, for his unwavering support and encouragement. His weekly phone calls kept me focused, and there were many robust discussions that helped me to overcome the significant opposition to this project. I thank him for his patience and dedication to my research, end quote. Martin himself has been a supporter of the Australian Anti-Vaccination Network's right to, quote, freedom of speech, end quote, if not the AVN itself, publishing a paper in 2015 titled, quote, On the Suppression of Vaccine Dissent, end quote. Mr. John Cunningham, orthopaedic surgeon at the Royal Melbourne Hospital and a member of SAVN, told the Medical Observer, quote, there is adequate scope for any student to write a thesis about vaccination policy in Australia, but it should be written from a factual standpoint. It is evident to all that Wileyman has a mistaken concepts of immune system, vaccination and pharmacology, hence her discussion is fundamentally flawed, end quote. Amongst the alleged factual issues, Cunningham said, is the claim that, quote, immunity occurs naturally in humans and without risk if the exposure occurs at the right time during childhood, end quote. This is not the case for diseases such as tetanus, he said. Also wrong, he said, is the claim that most conventional vaccinations have not been subjected to formal controlled trials using an inherent placebo. He also disputes the claim that, quote, there is no definitive evidence from formal controlled clinical trials comparing vaccinated participants to unvaccinated participants and demonstrating the efficacy of each vaccine against the infectious disease they are designed to prevent, end quote. In a statement on its website, the University of Wollongong has defended the approval of the PhD. Quote, University of Wollongong, UOW, ensures research is undertaken according to strict ethical and quality standards and supports researchers' academic freedom of thought and expression. UOW does not restrict the subjects into which research may be undertaken just because they involve public controversy or because individuals or groups oppose the topic or the finding. UOW does not endorse the individual views of its academics or students. It recognizes the importance of open and respectful public policy debate to the preservation of a free and democratic society. All UOW PhD theses are assessed by at least two examiners who are external to UOW, have unchallengeable knowledge in the field of study, have no conflicts of interest that would impede their examination, and there can be no more than one examiner in any one country, end quote. There is no mention that the claims made in the PhD thesis need to be accurate and supported by evidence. Cunningham said that, quote, the University of Wollongong has stated that her thesis has been assessed to their high standards. This obviously does not include having it assessed by someone with a working knowledge of medicine or vaccination, which serves as the basis of her argument, end quote. Professor Peter McIntyre, Director of the National Centre for Immunisation Research and Surveillance and an advisor to the World Health Organization, told the Australian newspaper that he had offered to advise Wileyman but withdrew his offer as she was, quote, not willing to entertain, end quote, evidence which contradicted her beliefs. The PhD was accepted via the School of Humanities. McIntyre observed that, quote, no doubt the examiners selected have credentials within the area of study, but they are likely to lack necessary credentials in health sciences that would enable them to be aware of the full picture here, end quote. Wileyman was previously working on her PhD at Murdoch University in Western Australia. In the past, she has made numerous disparaging comments about vaccination that have no foundation in science, such as the long discredited claims of a link between vaccination and autism. The numerous bent spoon nominations means that the University of Wollongong, or Woolongong, as one nominator calls, and Wileyman will feature as prominent candidates when the Australian Skeptics Annual Awards are announced later this year. And the transcript of that report can be found at www.skeptics.com.au.
G'day, this is Dr. Carl, Carl Krasinski, proud to be a skeptic, and you can find out more about me at drcarl.com and get lots of free stuff there as well.
Thank you for listening to The Skeptic Zone. Now, last week I mentioned that we'd be covering the Mark Zuckerberg story, where he had his little daughter taken to the doctor he took her herself to get some vaccinations, and the internet went into meltdown with the anti-vaccination zealots accusing him of all sorts of things. Well, other news stories sort of got in the way this week, but that's okay. We might still cover this story in the coming weeks. Thank you to Jo Alabaster and Dr. Rachie this week for stepping up and covering this important issue. And my snoops tell me that there is more to come on this PhD. Stay tuned. And while you're staying tuned, don't forget to go to maynard.com.au for all your Maynard wackiness and craziness and actually really good, interesting stuff. He's got his own podcast, of course, Bunga Bunga, he does with Tim Ferguson from the Doug Anthony All-Stars. Oh, that's fun. I've been a guest on that podcast a couple of times, and that's just crazy fun. Head to maynard.com.au, and he's one of our best reporters, of course, here on The Skeptic Zone. But for this week, this is Richard Saunders signing off from Sydney, Australia. You've been listening to The Skeptic Zone podcast. Visit our website at www.skepticzone.tv for contacts, an archive of all episodes since 2008, and our online store. Please support The Skeptic Zone by following us on Twitter at Skeptic Zone, liking us on Facebook, and leaving a review on iTunes. You can also show your support by subscribing via PayPal for as little as 99 cents a week. The Skeptic Zone is an independent production. The views and opinions expressed on The Skeptic Zone are not necessarily those of Australian Skeptics Inc. or any other skeptical organisation.